Hello everyone. So today we are going to discuss about bituminous mixes, and in this lecture we are going to discuss about the variety of material that are used for the formation of bituminous mixes, and then what are the desirable properties expected from a good bituminous mix, and then we are going to discuss about the testing procedure for the bituminous mixes. So let us start with the constituents of bituminous mixes. Your bituminous mix is composed of coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, filler and binder. Okay, so your coarse aggregate, as we know that whatever the load that is acted by the moving traffic, so whatever the load that is being acted by the moving traffic is taken up by the coarse aggregate. Okay, the coarse aggregate takes up the load and transfer it to the neighboring aggregate and thus disperse the load into the natural ground. Okay, so your coarse aggregate basically takes up the traffic load and transfer the load to the natural ground surface through aggregate to aggregate contact. Then we have fine aggregate, and the role of fine aggregate is that the fine aggregate, or first of all the fine aggregate fills up the voids that are present in between the coarse aggregate and does provide the denseness to the overall mix, right? So the fine aggregate, what they do is they provide the, they fill the voids that are present in between the coarse aggregate, and they provide the denseness to the mix, and thus they improve the load taking property of the overall mix. Then we have filler material, and filler material are added to the bituminous mix. The filler material is added to the bituminous mix so as to improve the adhesive property and to a certain extent fill the voids. So sometimes what happens is that either your fine aggregates are not sufficient enough to take up the voids that are present in between the aggregate, right? So in order to fill those voids and to improve the adhesive property between the aggregates and to improve the load taking property of the overall mix, we use filler. And conventionally, your stone dust, your cement and lime is used as a filler material. So whatever the spacing that is, or the void that is left by the after the filling of fine aggregate, that is filled by the, or that space, that voids are occupied by the filler material, and using cement or lime improves the overall adhesive property between the aggregate to aggregate, and thus to a certain extent improves the load taking property. And conventionally 1% to 2% of the filler material is used in the overall bituminous mix. Going for a percentage more than this is not desirable, and because what happens is then there will be a disproportionate proportion between the coarse aggregate and fine aggregate, right? The total quantity of coarse aggregate and fine aggregate, there will be a disproportion, and thus having higher amount of filler material will compromise its overall load taking property of the bituminous mix. And at the end we have a binder, and since we are talking about the bituminous mix, so the binder that is used for the adhesion between the aggregate is bitumen. Okay, so when you are talking about the bituminous mixes, bitumen is used as a binding material. All right, so bitumen is used to form the bond between the variety of, between the mixture of coarse aggregate, fine aggregate and filler. Okay, addition of filler is not a compulsory thing, right? Filler is added in the situations where the quantity of fine aggregate that we have used are not sufficient enough to fill up the voids, and if while designing we feel that the adhesive property should be improved, then we add cement and lime as a filler material. And the bitumen, depending upon the situation, depending upon the climatic condition in which the bitumen mix is to be laid, the type of bitumen is selected, and sometimes use of modified bitumen is also preferred based upon the conditions in which the bituminous roads will be subjected to. Now talking about the type of mixes, type of bituminous mix we have two type of bituminous mix. The first is well graded mix and the second is open graded mix. So in well graded mix, there is a proper distribution of each particle size of aggregate, right? We have a good proportion of variety of size of coarse aggregate, we have a good proportion of variety of size of fine aggregates, right? So the overall mix that we have contains various dimensions of coarse aggregate, various dimensions of fine aggregate. So the overall mix that we get through using these variety of coarse aggregate and variety of fine aggregate at a specific proportion, we get a dense mix, right? And having a dense mix makes it suitable to take up the heavy loading. Having a variety of aggregates, having a well graded gradation makes the mix suitable for the heavy loading condition. And if we are going for even if we are going for the light traffic volume road, we are going for medium traffic volume roads or heavy traffic volume road, we always prefer the well graded material, because having a well graded aggregate gives superior strength and perform very good in durability conditions. So the next mix that we have is open graded mix. Okay, and in open graded mix, what we have is we have a very less quantity of fine aggregate and filler material. Alright, so having a less quantity of fine aggregate and filler material, so this enables a lot of voids between the coarse aggregate. Okay, having less quantity of fines between in the overall mix enables presence of lots of voids between the bituminous mix. And having a lot of voids in between the mix enables or gives an opportunity to water to pass through it, right? Having a huge quantity of voids in between the mix gives an opportunity for the water to pass through these voids. So when we are going for construction of porous pavement, we use open graded mix. So if you want to construct porous pavement, we go for the open graded mix, and this mix is prepared by restraining the percentage of fine aggregate and filler in the overall mix. So if I say that conventionally, like 30 to 50% of the mix it contains fine aggregate, so in your open graded mix we have around 5 to 10% of the fine aggregate and filler. So the overall composition of fine aggregate and filler in the open graded mix is 5 to 10%, right? And this changes based upon the percentage of voids that you require in the overall mix, right? Now because of absence of fine aggregate in the porous mix, the load taking property of the open graded mix is inferior compared to the well graded mix. All right, so your open graded mix will not be able to take up the heavy loading as that was taken by the well graded mix, right? So these type of mix are used for extremely low volume roads. These are used for the construction of porous pavements, like and are installed in parking areas, in footpath, or as a divider, or in the areas which are subjected to very low volume or light vehicles type. All right. And in order to improve the adhesive property and in order to improve the durability properties of open graded mix, modified binders are used. Okay, so in your open graded mix, conventionally modified binder is used, because you see these open graded mix are used for the construction of porous pavement, right? And we know that bitumen has an affinity towards the water, right? Accumulation of water in a bituminous road basically leads to raveling process, right? It damages the adhesion between the aggregate and binder, right? So to counter that, and since we are going for porous pavement, the main use of porous pavement is to allow water to pass through it, right? So the porous pavement will always be in contact with the water, right? So to improve the adhesion property, to improve the resistance towards the moisture conditions, we use modified binders. And the modified binders are made with the use of क्रम रबर एंड वी हैव पॉलीमर बेस्ड बिटुमिन्स. ओके, एडिशन ऑफ वेरी फाइन रबर पार्टिकल्स टू द बिटुमिन और हैविंग अ वैरायटी ऑफ पॉलीमर्स, फॉर एग्जांपल स्टाइरीन, ब्यूटाडीन, स्टाइरीन आर हैव प्रूव टू बी वेरी एफिशिएंट फॉर द पोरस पेमेंट. नेक्स्ट लेट अस डिस्कस अबाउट द मेजर रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ बिटुमिनस मिक्सिस एंड द फर्स्ट वन इज स्टेबिलिटी. एंड स्टेबिलिटी इज डिफाइंड एज द रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ द पेविंग मिक्स टू द डिफॉर्मेशन अंडर ट्रैफिक लोड. टू अंडरस्टैंड सिंपली, स्टेबिलिटी इज रेजिस्टेंस टूवर्ड द लोडिंग कंडीशन, टूवर्ड द लोड और रेजिस्टेंस टूवर्ड द डिफॉर्मेशन. दैट इज the maximum amount of load that a bituminous mix can take before it fails. All right, so the maximum amount of load that will bitumen take before it deforms is called as stability. And needless to say that the stability of the bituminous mix will depend upon the interparticle friction or the type of aggregate we are using, right? If we are using round and smooth aggregate, right? If we are using round and smooth aggregate, so what will happen is upon the application of load, there will be sliding of aggregate that will take place, right? While if we have irregular aggregate with rough texture, if we have irregular aggregate with rough texture, so there is a friction between the aggregate, right? There is an appropriate amount of friction between the aggregate. So upon the action of even loading condition, the not only the adhesive bond between the aggregate caused by the bitumen used plus the interparticle friction will also resist that type of interparticle movement, right? So that will help us, that will help the bitumen to take up the more load and give you better stability. And the second thing that will give us better stability is the use of optimum binder content. Okay, the use of optimum binder content. An appropriate quantity of bitumen used for the adhesion between the coarse aggregate and fine aggregate will also give us better stability, because you see, if we have the binder content is less than the optimum value, if we have a binder content less than the optimum value, then what will happen is the coating will be uneven. We will have uneven coating. Okay, we will have uneven coating. Right, and because of improper coating, there won't be proper adhesion available between the aggregate to aggregate, and then the stability value that we will get will be less than the that could have been. If we use binder content more than the optimum value, then what will happen is we have excess amount of binder, right? And this excess amount of binder, what it will do is it will lead to sliding of aggregate over each other. Sliding of aggregates over each other. Okay, so having a quantity of binder less than the optimum value, we won't have a proper coating, and then the stability value that we will get will be less than that could have been. And if we have the binder content more than the optimum quantity, then there will be lubrication of bitumen over the aggregate that will take place, and this will again lead to the sliding of aggregate over each other. Next desirable property is the durability of the bituminous mix, and we have discussed durability is defined as the resistance of a material or a mix under adverse condition, right? So performance of bituminous mix under adverse condition like weathering and abrasive action is here referred as durability performance of the bituminous mix. Now the road that are made up of bituminous mixes are subjected to various environmental conditions, right? It is subjected to heat of the sun, right? It is subjected to heat of the sun, it is subjected to rain, right? It is subjected to rain, and in some cases it is also subjected to frost. It is also subjected to frost action. So when the bitumen is introduced to different weather condition, so what it does is it makes the bitumen hard. That is, there is a loss of volatile in the bitumen, and because of which the adhesive property of the bitumen is compromised, right? Because of the weathering situation, the adhesive property of the bitumen is compromised, and this will lead to premature failure of the pavement. Because you see, even in the different weathering condition, your traffic is always mobile, right? There is always a movement of traffic in no matter what the temperature condition is. And since the adhesive property of your bitumen is now weak and we have constant movement of the traffic, then of course premature failure of the pavement will take place. And the second condition is abrasive action, and abrasive action is the constant action of the tires over the road surface. So basically what happens is that because of movement of vehicles over the road, there is a a certain amount of loading that is being applied, and this load is basically transferred from one aggregate to other, right? This load is being transferred from one aggregate to the other. So if the type of aggregate that we have used are of inferior quality, then during the course of time there will be a crushing of aggregate. There will be crushing of aggregates, right? Plus there is weathering conditions the bituminous road is being subjected to. So coating over the aggregates again gets weakened. So these two scenarios weakens the bonding between the aggregate to aggregate, and again leads to the premature failure of the pavement, right? So it is of utmost importance that the behavior of the bituminous mix under durability scenario is superior. That is, the resistance of bitumen mix for the weathering condition and for the abrasive action is superior. And again, these can be done by using good quality of aggregates, good quality of fine aggregates, coarse aggregate, and the using the appropriate type of binder based upon the scenario. So the common example of failure under adverse condition, under weathering condition and abrasive condition, is formation of potholes. Initially, the formation of pothole is due to weak bond between the aggregate to aggregate, and the reduction in the adhesive property of the binder due to various action, and because of which the aggregate, because of the movement of the traffic, the aggregate start to pop out of the road surface, and we have a pothole scenario. And to make things worse, because of the rain water, there is accumulation of water in these potholes. Now what happens is, because of this accumulation of the water, the adhesion between the aggregate in contact with the water reduces, and this reduction in the adhesive layer makes the aggregate again to leave out the bituminous mixes. Okay, and then we have a stripping action. Stripping action is the loss of binder between the aggregate, right? We have aggregate, and over the aggregate we have the coating of binder. Now again, because of the durability condition, what happens is we have stripping action. The binder starts to strip over the aggregate surface. Now this removal again leads to removal of aggregate from the surface, right? So it is of utmost importance that the performance of the aggregate under durability condition is superior. Then the next parameter that we are interested in is the flexibility of the bituminous mix. So basically what happens is that the bituminous pavement, the bituminous mixes, or the road that are made up of bituminous mixes, exhibit certain amount of flexibility. So by this what we mean is that, suppose we have a bituminous road, okay, we have a bituminous road. Now when the load is being applied on the bituminous road in the form of moving traffic, the pavement is in contact with the load. So what happens here is there is a certain amount of deformation. Now this deformation takes place at a very micro scale level, right? Very small deformation, right? There is a very small deformation that takes place. Okay, a very small deformation takes place. Now what happens is, as the vehicle moves away, right, as the vehicle moves away from this road section, so now what happens is, the road regains its shape. The road regains its shape. So there, as soon as the application of load is there, there is a certain amount of deformation that takes place. As soon as the load is being removed, so what happens is, the recovery of that section takes place. Now this is a cyclic process, because we know that there is a constant movement of traffic, and not only one vehicle, there are n number of vehicles that are moving at the same time, right? So what happens is that as the bituminous road ages, right, as the there is a aging of bituminous road, so what happens is that this recovery becomes less, right? So what happens is, there will be deformation, but upon the removal of the road, there will be less amount of recovery, and this keeps on going on. Okay, and with time, what happens is, there is the deformation upon the action of the road, it keeps on deforming, and this leads to generation of cracks. Okay, these lead to generation of cracks. Now depending upon the type of binder we have used, type of aggregates that we have used, that is how well we have prepared the bituminous mix, controls the loss of flexibility behavior, right? If you use a optimum quantity of binder, if you use superior quality of aggregate, then your pavement will have the appropriate amount of flexibility during its service life, right? If we have used poor quality of aggregate, and we have not used the optimum quantity of binder as per the quality of the aggregate, then this loss of flexibility will be at an early stage than the desired pavement life, right? And this will lead to premature failure of the pavement. Next we have skid resistance, and in skid resistance we want our bituminous pavement to work very well under the skidding process, right? That is, it gives a better resistance toward the skidding of the vehicle over the road surface. After this we have workability, and workability is the ease of mixing. So we want that there is a certain amount of easiness in the mixing of bitumen with the aggregate. Now this again depends upon the type of gradation that we have, type of aggregate that we are using. If we are using more of a rough fractured aggregate with irregular surface, then the quantity of binder that will be used will be quite high. The mixing will be very tough, because you know the coating of bitumen in the small ridges over the surface of the aggregate will be very difficult, right? And if you are using smooth round aggregate, then in such scenarios there will be proper mixing of the aggregate with the binder. So these are the few of the desirable properties that we expect from the bituminous mix that we are which we will be using for the laying of road. After this, let us discuss the procedure for the mix preparation. So the first step in this is the testing of quality of material, that is testing the quality of material that we are going to use for the preparation of bituminous mix. And here we show the desirable property of coarse aggregate as per the Morse. And Morse asks for certain specific properties, that is cleanness, particle shape, strength, durability, water absorption, stripping, and water sensitivity. Then the quantity of binder that is to be used for the binding between the coarse aggregate and fine aggregate, dependent upon the temperature condition in which the road has to be laid upon. And if you are using VG30, then that VG30 must fulfill the desired parameter. This is again as per the Morse requirement. Then after deciding the type of material that we are using, that is after ascertaining that the material that we are using is as per the coarse specification, the next step is formation of gradation. Now in gradation, again we have to make sure that the coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, and filler if required, and the quantity of binder that we are using should form a mix that is dense and is suitable for the desired road conditions. Again, here is shown the ग्रेडेशन फॉर बिट्यूमिनस कंक्रीट पेवमेंट एज पर द मॉर्थ, ओके एज पर द मॉर्थ व्हाट इज द डिजायरेबल ग्रेडेशन, एंड वी कैन सी फॉर बिट्यूमिनस कंक्रीट, जस्ट लाइक बिट्यूमिनस कंक्रीट वी हैव डेंस बिट्यूमिनस मेगाडम, वी हैव स्टोन मैट्रिक एसफॉल्ट, वी हैव वैरायटी ऑफ मिक्सेस राइट हियर, जस्ट फॉर द रेफरेंस वी आर शोइंग बिट्यूमिनस कंक्रीट. So we can see that the code says that we can use two type of gradation for the bituminous mix depending upon the nominal size of aggregate, and show the type of distribution of variety of size of aggregate, and we can see that it contains a proportion of variety of aggregate, so it is a well graded mix. And then we have the quantity of binder that we have to use, that is the minimum quantity of binder that should be with respect to the type of gradation that we are using. So after putting the material in the desired gradation, so for example let us say that we have decided to prepare bituminous concrete of grade 1, that is our nominal size of aggregate is 19 mm, we have formed the desired gradation. Now what we'll do is we will find the binder content for the gradation. So depending upon the proportion of the variety of size of aggregate, we have to find the optimum quantity of binder that we have to use for the gradation that we have achieved, right? The code says that code suggests the minimum value, right? So if we are using grade 1 for bituminous concrete, then at least it should have 5.2% of the bitumen with respect to the overall mix that we have prepared, right? But what is the optimum quantity of binder that we will use? For this, we have to find out the optimum binder content. And for that, Marshall mix designing method is used. Now this is the equipment for the Marshall mix design. And here, this gauge gives the stability value. This gauge gives the stability value and this gives the flow value. Flow means the interlocking between the aggregates, right? The behavior of aggregate to aggregate contact, right? So this measures the flow value. I'm not going into much of the detail of the Marshall mix design because otherwise this lecture will become very long, right? I'm going to discuss in brief the Marshall mix design and then what is the output from the Marshall mix design. And this is the loading gauge, and here if you see, this is the sample that we have kept. Okay, so this is a sample of Marshall mix that we have kept. So your Marshall mix design procedure is as per MS2 asphalt mix design. And basically what we do in the Marshall mix design method is we prepare samples with different proportion. Right. So if you are going for grade 1, right, we are going for bituminous concrete grade 1, right? And here the code suggests that the minimum binder content should be 5.2%. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll prepare certain amount of samples with different binder content. So basically what we will do is we'll prepare a sample containing 5% binder. Okay, we'll prepare a sample containing 5% binder. We'll prepare another sample with 5.5% binder. So the gradation remains the same. The only thing changing from sample to sample is the quantity of binder. So this binder, let's say we have prepared with 5% bitumen. This sample we have prepared with 5.5% bitumen. Again, we prepare another sample with 6% bitumen. Then we have another sample with 6.5% bitumen. At the end, we prepare another sample with 7% bitumen. Okay, so you see, we have prepared 5 samples with different binder content. Okay. So we have prepared 5 samples with different binder content. Now what we'll do is we will test each of these samples for their stability value. We will test each sample, or let's say each sample till their failure. Okay, we will test each sample till their failure, and through this we will find their stability value, we will find their flow value, and these values are given by the dial gauge that are present. This dial gauge give us the stability value, this dial gauge give us the flow value. In the Marshall testing procedure, we also find the theoretical specific gravity and the bulk specific gravity. Bulk specific gravity. Alright, and through this, what we do is we also find out the percentage air void. And through this, we also find out the percentage air voids in each sample. So, suppose we have found out theoretical specific gravity of this sample, we have found out the bulk specific gravity of this sample, right? And the volume of void in this sample can be found out by g theoretical minus g bulk divided by g theoretical into 100. So through this we can find out the percentage void that are present in the sample. Likewise, we'll find percentage void in each of the sample. Okay, we will find out the percentage voids in each of the samples. And along the testing procedure, we also find out various other parameters like percentage volume of bitumen, voids in mineral aggregate, void filled with bitumen. So your this bulk specific gravity is found out by taking the weight of the sample in air and the weight of the sample in the water. That is taking the weight in the submerged condition, right? Theoretical specific gravity is found out through vacuum suction process, or we have a formula where each weight of this material that we have used, let me write it down that also. So your G theoretical is found using taking weight of the coarse aggregate, taking weight of the fine aggregate, taking weight of the filler if used, taking weight of the bitumen that we have used, and dividing each with their specific gravity, and dividing each with their apparent specific gravity. Likewise, all right. So through this, we also find out the various other parameters. So after following the Marshall, after testing each of the Marshall sample in the Marshall equipment, after testing each sample with Marshall testing equipment and following the Marshall testing procedure, we get graphs. So now let us discuss the various graphs that we get after testing each sample. So the first graph that we will get is the stability graph. So in this, what happens is, in the x-axis, what we put is different samples with different binder content. Okay, we have tested various samples with variety of binder content. So we, in the x-axis, we put the percentage of bitumen. Okay, so we have a sample that was prepared at 5% binder content. We had a sample that was prepared at 5.5% binder content, and the sample was prepared at 6% binder content. Likewise, 6.5 and 7% binder content. So what we do is that we test each sample in the Marshall testing equipment, and through that we get a stability value for each sample, right? So we get a stability value for each sample, and that stability value is represented in the y-axis. So your y-axis is the stability value. So what happens is, sample 1 that is prepared with 5% binder content will give you a certain value, sample 2 will give you certain value, sample 3 will give you certain value, and after certain point, after up to here, what was happening is that addition of bitumen was contributing towards the load taking property of the binder, right? Bitumen was contributing towards the load taking property of the binder. So basically, after this point, what will happen is that now addition of further amount of binder will basically it will act as a lubricant. It will act as a lubricant. It will, instead of providing proper adhesion and cohesion between the aggregate, it will act as a lubricant and will promote the sliding of aggregate over each other. So if we go beyond this point, then there will be decrease in the stability value. So then by joining this, we'll get a graph. Okay, so this is your stability graph. Next we have the next data that we'll get is flow value. The next data after testing the sample we will get is flow value. Alright, so in this sample through here we get the stability value and this give us the flow value. Right, and as you can see this is the sample, right? If you see, this is the sample that we have got for the testing. Again, we'll get the data in the graphical form, and in the x-axis we again have variety of binder content that we have used, and here we have the flow value in the y-axis. This is the flow value in the y-axis. Now, as we have discussed just now, that the flow value, what it does is it sees the behavior of the particle to particle contact. That is how the aggregate is behaving. So upon the addition of if we go beyond the optimum binder content, so what will happen is there will be a internal sliding of the aggregate that will take place, right? So as we increase the quantity of binder, there will be increase in the flow value. Okay, so there will be increase in the flow value as we keep on increasing the quantity of binder. So the graph that we get for the flow value is always of this shape. The third parameter that we get through the testing of Marshall stability is, so the third parameter that we get is unit weight. So just like stability, up to a certain point there will be increase in the specific gravity, and after that there will be a decrease in the specific gravity of the sample. Okay, there will be a decrease in the unit weight of the sample. The fourth data that we get is percentage air voids. And can you guess what the proportion of coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, and if filler is used, the proportion of coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, and filler is same, right? So the overall proportion is same, the size of the sample is same. The only thing that is changing is the binder content. We are increasing the binder content, right? And that binder content, after a certain point of time, after it lubricates the coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, the binder content, after being used for the binding purposes, the excess of the binder content will occupy the percentage voids that are present in the sample. So the graph will be always decreasing. The graph will be always decreasing. The next is void filled with bitumen, in short known as VFB. So here what VFB is, the percentage of bitumen that fills the void. VFB is percentage of bitumen that fills the void. So again, as we are going for the increment in the binder content, the value keeps on increasing. Next is voids in mineral aggregates. Voids in mineral aggregates, also called as VMA. So the value of VMA is equal to the total quantity of voids that are present in the bituminous mix plus the volume of bitumen that we have used. And the graph that we get of VMA, the graph that we get of VMA, at first it decreases and then it increases. So at first the value decreases and then it increases. It may not go this much high. This is the percentage bitumen everywhere. X-axis is percentage bitumen. Conventionally, the voids in mineral aggregate normally decreases, but sometimes it also observed to be increasing. The reason for this is the segregation of the material that takes place upon the addition of binder, right? So these are the graphs that we get through the testing of sample. So for a quick revision, We have prepared 5 samples. Each sample is of a different van der Kandel, and then we tested through the Marshall testing equipment. And through that, by following the Marshall procedure, we get the following values. Now we have to choose the optimum van der Kandel. Our ultimate aim of doing everything was to choose the optimum van der Kandel. And the optimum van der Kandel value is the van der Kandel that gives maximum stability, 4% air void, and maximum specific gravity. So the next step that we do is we take the maximum stability value, the van der Kandel that gives the maximum unit weight, and the van der Kandel that is giving 4% air void. So let's say this is the van der Kandel, this is the 4% value, and the van der Kandel that is giving us 4% air void is this. So let's say we have 5.9% van der Kandel is giving maximum stability value, 5.4% van der Kandel is giving us maximum unit weight, and we have 5.4% van der Kandel is giving us the 4% air void. So what we'll do is we'll take an average of all these three. Okay, we'll take an average, and the average will be 5.9 plus 5.4 plus 5.4 divided by 3. So let's say this value comes out to be 5.57. okay, we can take it as 5.6%. So this is the optimum van der Kandel. All right, this value is the optimum van der Kandel value. So for the gradation that we have used, we have found out the optimum van der Kandel that is equal to 5.6%. Okay, so this is how we find out the optimum van der Kandel. All right, so after finding out the optimum van der Kandel, okay, so the next step is that we will prepare sample at the optimum van der Kandel. Okay, what we'll do is we will prepare another sample. Normally 3 replicas are prepared. We'll prepare 3 samples at the optimum van der Kandel. Right, so we'll prepare 3 samples at the optimum van der Kandel and test for the stability value, air void value, and VFV values. Because as per the Moth, here again is the Moth specifications, and it says that the stability value required for viscosity grade paving bitumen, that is VG bitumen. Okay, that is VG bitumen. The minimum stability value is 9. Okay, the sample that is prepared with the optimum van der Kandel or the bituminous mix should have a stability value of 9 kN, must have a Marshall flow value in between 2 to 4. Conventionally, 3 is accepted. Must have an air void of in between 3 to 5, and since we have already taken 4% as our criteria, so this is normally fulfilled, and the VAB value should be 65 to 75. Okay, you will find also so these criteria must be fulfilled by the sample that has been prepared at the optimum van der Kandel value. Okay, so this is how your bituminous mix is prepared. These are the steps in which your bituminous mix is prepared. Conventionally, now you see what is happening is, since VAB is also a criteria. So if you are, so conventionally now in practice, what field engineers are doing is that instead of taking average of 3, they are taking average of 4 values. Okay, so the VAB that is lying in between 65 to 75, that is 70 VAB value, they are taking average of that van der Kandel also, just to be safe. Traditionally, these three are used. Okay, so this was all about your bituminous mixes. I hope the lecture was clear to you. And if still you have any doubt, you can ask in the comment section. Okay, so this was all about the bituminous mixes. I hope the lecture was clear to you. And even if you have any doubt, please ask in the comment section. And if you like the video, hit like button. Consider subscribing to the channel if you find this video useful. We have a lot more lectures coming in the coming days. And so this was all about. Thank you.